What's the first word that comes to your mind when you think of September?
21st.
September.
You said September.
That's what I'm thinking of. I think it's September.
Do you remember? Do you have any idea how much crap is in this track?
They freaking tuned the congas.
That's too.
All that and more today on Professional Musicians React.
Musicians React.
Welcome to Professional Musicians React. We got an awesome day today. We are listening to Earth, Wind, and Fire, September.
Woo!
We got Charles Jones. Charles has played with Raphael Sadiq. Wolfpack did a tune with Wolfpack a couple of years ago. We got Ryan Lerman here. Ryan has played with John Legend and folks like Ben Folds, played bass for Ben Folds for many years. We got Tim Sonnefeld, who's engineering today, and you're hearing his voiceover talk back here. My name is Jack Conte. I'm the CEO of Patreon, and we're gonna dive into Earth, Wind, and Fire September. Before we dive in, what are you listening to right now?
Willy Wonka soundtrack, like Pure Imagination.
One of the greatest songs of all time.
One of the greatest song orchestrations.
Oh my God.
All time.
We'll begin with a spin, traveling in the world.
Do you know Lewis Taylor?
Mm-mm.
It blew my mind. His record, his self-titled record, was recorded in the 90s, I think. And he's playing everything, and it's insane. So come on, won't you let me be
there? My most listened to record is Impressions for Headphones by Brian Green. This record puts me in a zone. It's like, it makes me feel like I'm driving through the rain, and it's beautiful. It's a feeling the whole way through. It's lo-fi, it's gorgeous.
I love that record.
It's a great record. All right, let's dive in. We got Earth, Wind, and Fire, September. This song was originally released as a single. It wasn't on a record. Did you know that?
No.
It's on the Best of Earth, Wind, and Fire, Volume 1.
That's what it came
out of? A compilation?
Yeah, that's the record that it's on, like officially, because it was a single. This song was released in 1978 in November.
Oh my God.
Produced by Maurice White, the band leader. Maurice also played with Etta James, Chuck Berry, Buddy Guy. Here we go. Oh, I love that piano.
I do too.
Everything else is so upbeat.
God.
Oh. Makes me want to go to a bar mitzvah.
Wait, in all seriousness, one thing I love about this song is it is a party start to finish.
Oh my God.
Can you play? Yes. Yeah, do you hear that?
Yeah, I hear it.
It's totally a wind-up. It just like, it's like, ladies and gentlemen. It's so great.
He said, listen, you're going to hear this damn part.
I love it. Charles, when we sat down right before we started listening to this, right before we turned on the cameras, you were playing the tune on keys.
Yeah.
Can you just play what you played?
So I was playing, do you remember? Yeah.
You don't hear that anywhere.
Nope. You do not.
That
you do
is
not.
Constructed
yeah.
with a lot of different melodic lines
mm-hmm.
happening at the same time, almost like, you know, a great Bach piece is lots of melodies at once. The bass player. Boom, 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 boom.
Yeah.
And then the guitar doing
And then so quick on the left hand, you have that guitar dun, 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 and then the guitar on the right is going dun, 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 dun,
dun, dun. Yeah. The James Brown thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then when you combine all those individual lines, you get harmony.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Nobody's playing the chords. It's these wonderfully composed intersecting counterpoint lines.
Mm. Yeah, that's what makes a genius of them.
Yes. Counterpoint lines are two melodic lines that are doing different things and moving sometimes in opposite directions, sometimes in similar directions, but playing different melodies.
It's insane. Like there's so many things going on. Even the crazy thing about this also is even in the percussion, the percussion are making chords. So like you have the conga, I think the conga's playing at one point like an F sharp. And then there's like a constant, I don't know what's playing, but there's like a constant thing.
On the backbeats.
On the backbeat that's like hitting the tonic every time.
Yes. Yes.
And then like goes to
in
like
the right
a.
side, right?
Yeah, on the right side.
Can
exactly.
we listen to that? Listen to this.
Yeah.
Oh, it's not on the backbeats.
Every single thing is tuned. Like every single thing, like every sound. That's what I was zoning into. I was like, wait a minute, that's tuned. That's tuned. That's tuned. That's tuned. Like
you do have perfect pitch, right?
You have perfect pitch. Yeah. Yeah. I'm tripping.
It must be 100 tracks. And they're so meticulously crafted. Each one of them, they freaking tuned the congas. You know what's funny though? Like, man, they left the piano in.
Mm-hmm.
But it's almost, first of all, it sounds like a tack piano to me. It's a super bright piano, right? There's like no low end. It's just all top.
Yeah, it sounds like a CP70.
It does sound like a CP70 or a CP80, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. The CP70 is an electric piano. It looks like a grand piano that was used in the late 70s.
They leave it so low in the mix. You almost, like, I didn't even know. When I think of September, I don't hear a piano part in my head.
Right.
Yeah.
But I bet if you muted it, you'd feel it missing. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's taking up a sonic space. There's just so much other stuff to pay attention to.
Yeah,
to me, this is just like, what a feat of mixing.
Yes.
Like, do you have any idea how much crap is in this track? I mean, there's like three guitar parts. There's like eight vocal tracks. There's a horn section. There's strings. There's percussion. There's drums. And everything sounds like exactly where it should be. You can pick out all the different parts.
It feels like the orchestral sensibilities of the 50s, those Bing Crosby recordings with, you know, strings and horns and you know, symphonic orchestration.
In the evening.
Plus the funk musicianship of the 60s and 70s. Oh, baby, give me one more chance. Show me that love you. And you combine those two things and you get the orchestra plus those just tight musicians that are playing so well together.
Everything is talking together so well. It's like hearing this song now, because it's like bop, bop, ba da da ba da da bop, bop, and then a bop, bop, and then it ends go bop, 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 bop. And then where at one point, like where the horns go, bop. It's a masterclass.
We just got to use the last 30 seconds.
I'm going to go back and watch which what's happened 5 or 6 times. That was incredible.
Charles, talk us through this sus chord coming out of the chorus. It's such an iconic sound, that sort of kitchen sink chord. Every funk band and their mothers does it now. Scary Pockets does it all the time. It's kind of like our go-to, like, turnaround chord. Yes.
Yeah.
Which
that's,
is...
That's just me notes, though, but yeah. Then the vocal. Is it over there?
Yeah, what is that? That's a 1 and a 5, right?
Yep, it's just a 1, 3, 5. When you have like polychords and like and different instrumentation and things, like it makes it sound so much better than when one instrument's playing all that.
Yeah.
It's so nice.
Exactly.
Okay, so question for you.
Yeah.
Let's talk about process for a second. When they were doing this, does the band get into the studio, they record the rhythm section first, and then they send it to a horn and string arranger? They're in such tight conversation with each other. It makes me feel like there was collaboration early on in the process.
I just think there is, because when you see them live, it's a collective. It's just like I went to the 40th anniversary concert in Vegas.
Wow.
And it just was like they had strings, they had horns, they had everything. And it's just like every element was valued. It wasn't like mm-hmm. one thing was more important than the other. It's just like the horns felt like they were just as important as Philip Bailey singing Reasons.
Yeah. Reasons,
you know.
If he's singing lead and I'll sing the high part, I'll mm-hmm. keep the balance within the structure. And then when I'm singing something, he'll keep the high part. So we go back and forth. Long as one of us is present vocally in the stage production, it keeps the sound. Mm-hmm. Dig what I'm saying?
One little topic to check out is the lyric Badia.
Yeah, well, okay.
You might not want to bring this up because you're a humble guy, but we should talk. We should talk about one of the seminal covers of this song by a band called Pomplamoose. And I remember when this came out, and one of the writers of the song got in touch with you because she liked it, Allie Willis.
Yep.
And you went over to, she invited you to come to her house to write with her.
She did.
And did she tell you the story of Badia?
I don't remember if that's how I heard about it, but I think it was that, yes. And after meeting her, it became very clear how that happened. But Allie Willis, who was in the studio with the band when they wrote the song, is a very like instinct-driven, whatever comes out of my mouth kind of songwriter. She'll just be like, da-da-da-da-da, and then she's like, okay, that's the hook. Let's build a whole song around that. And like she just like it just like came out. Yeah. You know, she's like all instinct, all impulse.
Yeah.
But it's just like gold that comes out.
Maurice really taught me the most important song lesson I ever got, which was never let the lyric get in the way of the groove. That if this sounds great, this is, you know, what it's going to be.
Do you know which other song today, like, where the primary lyric is Badia?
Isn't it like a Doja Cat song?
Megan Thee Stallion. Badia, yadi, 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 yadi. Yeah,
but she's talking about her body.
She's talking about her body.
Oh.
Sorry, thank you for the clarification.
Not body yaddy.
No,
it's body, like body.
Body yaddy, but it sounds exactly the same. No, if you just change the meaning of it.
Interesting. Let's do some factoids and get into some questions. Before we do that, we make these videos every week. If you like them, don't forget to subscribe. Don't forget to like the video. Every like helps. Every subscribe helps. We're coming out with new episodes of Professional Musicians React every week. New songs, new artists, new albums, new bass lines. So definitely subscribe if you're enjoying it. Let's get into some factoids for the lightning round here. How did Earth, Wind, and Fire get their name?
It's a great question.
I feel like I should know this.
Great question.
I don't.
Earth, Wind, and Fire got their name from founding member Maurice White's astrological sign. White's sign is Sagittarius, which has the primary elemental quality of fire and the seasonal qualities of earth and air. Earth, air, and fire didn't sound right, so air became wind.
Yeah.
Wow.
What sport has adopted September as its theme song?
There's a sport with this as its theme song?
Yes.
I don't know.
I have no
soccer.
Idea.
Soccer?
No way.
Everybody loves soccer. Like,
what do you got, Charles? What key do you want me to sing in?
You can sing any key you want. Okay.
Whoa, one, two, three. Whoa, whoa. England are in Russia. Whoa, whoa. Drinking all the vodka. Whoa, whoa. England's going all the way.
I just wonder, like, if they took the melody and then, like,
wait, Charles, I just got to ask for a second. I don't understand perfect pitch. Can you explain to us what it's like?
It's just like I hear notes and I know what key songs are in. But here's the, because many people don't talk about like the curse of it.
Okay.
So here's the caveat. This is the part that sucks. I had a gig at somebody's house and their piano was literally a whole step out of tune. So I'm playing, so like, let's say if I'm playing an F, right? You know? And it's a G, I constantly, in every chord,
you're hearing something.
I'm hearing something different, and I'm constantly trying to change it to the key.
Okay, so for folks who don't know, here's what perfect pitch is. Charles, don't look at my hands.
Okay. F, D, B flat.
You can hear notes like we see colors. Like
yes.
Jack and I look at that, we're like green, red, For you, notes are like that, right? Where as soon as it happens, you just know what it is.
I just know what it is.
Like this.
F sharp, yeah.
that'll never stop tickling me. Okay, we're wrapping up here. We got a couple questions from Discord subscribers, Discord members before we call it here. This one is from Jeff Sorensen from our Discord. The question is, what touring ritual do you miss the most? What part of touring do you miss the least?
Yeah, I can go first.
The second part of your question, Jeff, is Ryan's farts. I miss those. No, I'm just kidding. I miss honestly being in a van with people. I love the 6-hour drives between cities.
Being spoken in a van, like someone who hasn't done enough van touring.
It's true. I don't tour very much. Oh. Pompalouse never really toured. We made our living. We owned our masters, so we made our living from records, not from touring. So we've done, I don't know, half a dozen tours for a week each.
I don't miss the van. I don't miss the van rides. Like, I miss reacting to what's happening in the room. So, like, for me, if I'm doing my own thing, I would change a whole set based upon what the room feels like. And I'd be like, oh, this doesn't feel like this. Let's change everything, you know? And I miss, like, the spur of the moment of creating that, like, being in that space and, like, feeling the vibe of the people and the energy and friends and, you know, just kind of like, oh, this is what the room is like.
There's also this moment after a good show and you walk back into the green room together and everybody's just fucking high and excited and shouting and like, I miss that moment a lot. That was fun.
After a good show for me, like, I've had that, we have this like collective moment of quietness. Like, we'll get through a show and we'll come back and we'll just kind of sit and look at each other and we'll like be silent for like.
So, yeah, that's more my vibes. I was gonna say, this is a real, I was like, yeah, I don't like those best moments. I'm that. I'm just like, okay.
But like, that was something.
Wow. One of my favorite parts of touring is my ritual, is I'll just like put on my headphones and walk through like a new city. You know what your day looks like, you know, you're gonna do your thing and then you're gonna sound check and then you're gonna get dinner with your friends. And then it's just like that sort of anticipation of looking forward to stuff, being in a new city, listening to good music. Those are my favorite moments. Shows are fun too. I guess it depends on who you're touring with.
Okay, next question from a Discord member and patron, I'm presuming. Do you have any recommendations for headphones that work well for listening to music?
There's this company called Grado Headphones, and they make this headphone. It's called like the Model 300, something like that. I love listening to it because it's an open back, so therefore it's not like enclosing, but it's like there. And everything just sounds like the way it should, and it's just really clear.
For studio, Beyerdynamic DT770s. Mm. Those are my favorite.
I use the Sennheiser HD280s, which they're like, I think they're like $100 or maybe $150. Tim, I want to know what headphones you use.
280s, baby.
HD280s?
That's my favorite headphone.
Oh, shit!
Wow.
Yes. Great. Awesome. Thank you for watching Professional Musicians React. That was Earth, Wind, and Fire September. There's new episodes every week, so please subscribe for more Professional Musicians React future episodes. Coming. We'll see you soon. Arrivederci.